role of technology in the need and growth of career and college guidance and skill assessment businesses. The panelists for this session are Nithya Prabu, the founder at Lurnable in UK, Mr. Muralidhar S, who is the founder and CEO at Lodestar, Mr. Prateek Bhargava, the founder and CEO at Mindler, Mr. Aditya Bose, the founder and CEO at ProBano, and finally, Mr. Kaushik Bellani, who is the business and who's a business and strategy consultant. He's also the moderator for this session. Panelists, please.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I guess when you have a large panel to follow, it's going to be a tough act. Half the crowd is going with the panel because it's the biggest panel earlier. Thank you for staying back. My name is Kaushik Bellani, and I guess we've got a very sparse crowd. So can all of you hear me at the back there? Right at the back, can you hear me? Okay, great. I was not sure if I was loud enough. You know, what we're going to talk about is a new segment, actually. This is a segment in the education business which is not really well known. It's not considered glamorous and sexy out there. There are no unicorns as yet in this business. It's about the career guidance and stream selection, college selection business. It's an up-and-coming segment. It's a new category. And so first I'm going to ask my fellow panelists whether it's really needed and are they really doing anything worthwhile in this category and try and get their answers to that. Secondly, what is the role of technology in this segment? I'm sure they'll come up with some great answers to talk about. And I want to just, before we get into the panel, I've observed that all the panels since morning have not given enough attention to the audience. So I'm going to flip the model to ask the audience as to why they are still hanging around here at the end of the whole day. What is their objective? So anyone wants to ask their questions up front, please raise their hand and I'll ask you what your questions are. Yeah, please, can you get the mics across? I'm going to flip it around because all of you waited the whole day to be a part of the panel. So I want to hear from you, what is your question about the panel on career guidance and counseling businesses and the role of technology. So anyone, please raise your hand. Yeah, Utkarsh.
I definitely have a question because I've been like in touch with a lot of career assessment, career guidance kind of companies. But the one thing I see is that there's definitely an offline, I would say supplemental business running for these tech platforms as well. So how do we achieve scale there is my major question, because I'm sure you must be speaking to a lot of probably co-entrepreneurs or investors in the sector. So how do you see that?
So it's a scale for offline, right?
Absolutely. This business. Because, okay. Because it has a major part,
sure,
offline.
Yeah. Sure. Okay. Yes, ma'am. The lady in red. Obviously, today is Valentine. She's appropriately dressed. Thank you.
I said it doesn't matter that I'm at an EdTech summit. May as well dress for the occasion.
Same here.
So I work with Unilever, and I work with an initiative called the Fair and Lovely Career Foundation, which is in fact in the business of introducing young women across the country to free online career guidance and skilling resources. We also hope to get into job opportunities. I guess my question is that the reality for most young people across the country is they will have to consider careers that may not be extremely sexy. For instance, retail is pitched to be one of the largest job creators, but you don't get a lot of students aspiring for retail jobs versus, you know, government teaching jobs or jobs in banking. And I want to know how much of your work is focusing now on managing and correcting that mismatch between the jobs that actually exist and the studies that some of these children are engaged in, because you know they can go on studying, they can do masters and PhDs, but the jobs are not evolving at the same pace. So I guess that's my
question. Mismatch question. How is Oli? What's your name, ma'am?
My name is Anjali.
Anjali. Thank you, Anjali. Naam to suna yoga, right? Okay, great. Thanks for that question, Anjali. We'll get answered. Any other question? Yes, sir. The gentleman in the back. Okay. Great.
We're required to support them at least to that extent. So that's the first answer.
Thank you. Thank you for that.
Yeah, at least two of them there. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The second, the second question, general point is, how painful is it for career guidance guys to deal with principals and difficult parents? And if you can give us unfortunate school principals and directors some tips as to how to deal with them when this career counseling thing happens. Because we often feel that we face a huge roadblocks on it. How can we work together on it? And secondly, in the name of scale, and always scale happens, how about getting the people think better in terms of career guidance than going to scale every time? My summary is, first do the right job before you search for money, rather than give us the money, we'll do the right job. Thank you.
Got it. Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Principal. In fact, that was one of my next question was, how many principals are there so that I could ask them to go full ballistic or hold back? So that's the answer. There are some principals, so guys, take it easy. Okay. What's your question, sir? The last question before we get to the panel.
Hi. So traditionally, career guidance has been traditionally offline, and it has been based on how capable the counselor you're going to or the individual you're going to is. And that is why I want to know how technology is enabling it to scale the business. Thank you.
Okay. So you said it's traditional, right? It's traditional and consulting and guidance, right? How technology is going to take it to scale? Yeah, traditionally. Okay, great. So one more question, ma'am. I'm going to come to you first, and then I'm going to go there. Yes, please.
Yeah. So my question is, since we're talking about career guidance, if we look at India as a country, the mass lies in vocational skilling rather than the higher education or the technology-driven skills that we've been talking about since morning. That's another reason that I'm still hanging around, because I want to see what is the role technology is playing to enable vocational skilling. And unfortunately, I've not been able to really gather that since morning. But even from a career guidance perspective, what we see today is there is a lot of mismatch between interest of the youth, the aspirations of the youth, and finally the career that they end up in, specifically from a vocational perspective.
Got it.
So is there something that we are doing specifically addressing the vocational side?
So is this career guidance available for vocationals, or technology is going to role to play, right? But I completely agree with you. We don't need no education, right? Get on to vocational skills. The gentleman at the back, the last one.
Sir, thank you. India, as ma'am rightly mentioned, is a large mass. So are we going from top-down approach, that is from urban to the rural, or we are going from rural to urban? This is a bottom-up approach. As a career guidance specification, technology platform, whether it can penetrate in a rural area and we can have a larger business actually through that. Question number to that, how government subsidies continuously which are flowing in various forms will affect privatization of education. People are not ready to pay actually because government subsidies are flowing. So how we are going to overcome these problems?
Thank you, sir. Are you an entrepreneur?
I'm an educationist as well as an entrepreneur together,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So lots of questions. Yeah, that proves my point that the people who are staying back, gentlemen, lady, are really interested in the outcomes. So let's talk about, you heard all the questions. And I'm going to straight away dive into our panel. Thank you for all the questions. So career guidelines is supposed to be done traditionally with evolved, learned, wise consultant. And you can see on the panel, you can see a very clear age difference in the panelists, right? On both sides, they're very young people. So I'm going to turn one to the right. Aditya, are you out of college really to be on this panel giving career advice? Right?
1.5 years.
1.5 years. So he runs a company called ProBano. So is it ProBano and Papu Nahi, right?
Huh.
Okay. So why don't you tell us what do you want to, your views on career guidance and how we're using technology to get to the market?
Sure. So hi everyone, this is Aditya from ProBano. Pro is in English and Bano is in Hindi. So we are into the high school education market. Now, what I think about career guidance specifically is that, there were many questions asked about the scaling and the role of technology into it. I personally feel that you cannot take the personalization of career guidance, right? So, because students really like to have their questions addressed by someone who is an expert who can guide them. Now, the thing is that, you know, in many cases, if even if you, you know, scale the whole thing through an online course, through online content, through, you know, content which we can train certain counselors on, there will always be heterogeneous questions coming from different cultures, coming from different states, different, you know, mindsets. So all those questions have to have a person who is addressing them after the initial role of technology comes into play. So I believe it goes in the same methodology as flipped classrooms go through. You know, initially you show them the content or, you know, the framework on how to make the right career choice, on decision making strategies, which will also help you, you know, kind of sustain this kind of career decision making, even when you don't know what lies in the future, what kind of careers are going to come up in the future. At least if you have the right decision making strategy in your mind, at least you know, you know, how to adapt to that change and how to sustain through the changes in the career ecosystem. So there needs to be an online online and a scalable part to it, but also you need to scale the offline processes to the career counseling, you know, access to a mentor, access to a career counselor, access to somebody who can answer my specific questions. So that needs to be there. And talking about, you know, the government versus private thing, career guidance is one thing that we have to focus on making it accessible to everyone, the people who are looking for, you know, the highest of the high jobs, and the people who are looking for, you know, kind of vocational jobs for an initial start. And we have to make it inclusive. You know, it has to be cost effective for the people who cannot afford very high end career guidance, and who, you know, at places where, you know, there's not much of internet access also. So we have to kind of make it inclusive for everyone. People who are from the bottom of the pyramid, people who have disabilities, for everyone. So that, you know, we can get more of these people also into the labor force.
Okay, Aditya, so you talk basically a hybrid model is what you're talking about, right? But you're talking about college level. But I think the problem really starts earlier, and I, you know, looking at the questions which came in, probably much earlier in school, and when do we really start? So Prateek, I want you to talk about, you know, what do you do, and in this area, do you start early? But before that, also keep in mind that, you know, how do you deal with painful parents and principals, right? The questions come in and you work in that area. And, you know, some of the skeptical parents might ask, even ask, is the category really essential? I mean, why do you need to do this?
Okay, so I'll start with the first bit in terms of introducing the organization. So I'm Prateek Bhargav. I'm the founder of Mindler. In a nutshell, what we are an organization which is endeavoring to be the brain behind all the career recommendations that are being generated, empower the stakeholders which are doing that, and make this entire process as free of human bias as possible. So that's a broad endeavor. Now, when we work on this, we are three broad elements that we focus on. One is the three steps towards career planning, which is A is career discovery, B is mapping, and then is the planning bit. And for ages, the process has been primarily focused on the planning part, whereas I think the most important bit is the discovery. And I'll give you stats. About 93% students in India can't even name more than 7 careers. Okay. Now, if they don't even know there are careers that exist, there is no way they can pursue them. And to be honest, we are looking at an age wherein, if you look at the top 10 careers of today, they did not exist 10 years ago. So if any one of us says that we know what is going to be there, it's not true. However, we still need to prep these guys as they are moving forward with regards to what is recent today, what you can foresee happening. And thus comes the role of the mapping bit, which is helping the students evaluate what are their key skill sets. And we made a huge effort in terms of doing a ground up research. We actually spent about 16 months, 40 odd PhDs in developing a product ground up in terms of understanding with our culture and our requirements, what is essential to be mapped, bringing in elements like emotional intelligence, new age aptitudes, which are actually relevant in the Indian context. We did that. And then obviously is the planning bit wherein the role of mentors and all comes in. Now, when we look at implementing this, A, we work with some of the leading schools across the country and even overseas, wherein we try and bring a curriculum approach to career guidance, which is almost like the way maths or science is taught, bringing a similar approach to that with very clear outcomes and telling school principals. And that's where the principal bit comes in, is that just in today's time, just getting marks and having a 90% plus is not enough. You need to have an all-round profile. You need to do a lot of additional things. A school's capability should also be measured in the diversity of careers the students are pursuing. If it's a school wherein, let's say, the 21 out of 24 sections which are just studying PCM, It is not humanly possible that every kid is meant for engineering as a career. So we help solve that problem using the end output. So that's one side of the issue. The other is that human element, which something like what Utkarsh mentioned, the human element is very important. However, when you look at skilling, when you look at vocational, when you look at even top schools, in fact, for that matter, you go to schools, you ask teachers, let's pick up a biology teacher, and if you ask her, what are the careers in with biology if you don't want to pursue medicine, 90% of them will not have answers. They will not be aware. So it's training them also. So what we do on the other side is we run a complete credentialing program, which allows people to partner with us and use the Mindler platform as a SaaS product. Okay, so, and these are people generally entrepreneurial, right? They don't want to work for anyone. I have people based out of Bhilai, in Mysore, in Pathankot. Now they just use their platform. So it could be anybody's .mindler.com, their white label names or something. They have all assessments available. They have extensive libraries available. They have end-to-end data. You click on a career, whether it is fashion communication, game development, Indianized information of what are the colleges, what are the exams, how do you go about it. We give them automated planners wherein you can just enter, let's say you want to pursue law as a career, all the colleges come down, all the courses come down. People don't even know today law is not just BLLB, it could be BTech LLB, BCA LLB, BBA LLB. So all that information once these guys have, and then we power it with what is something which is unique to us. We have developed our machine learning driven career guidance inputs. Okay, so these are pre-coded questions in a system which a student has to answer, and the system gives an analytical response as to what a top-notch counselor would have given you, and this empowers the guy at the bottom rung. So that's what we are trying to do on both the ends.
Great. So that means you've solved the scale problem, you've solved the urban-rural issue, and you've also covered a spectrum of careers ranging from law to retail across the board, right? And it works in schools, it works for counselors as well, right? But you know, I guess this is something which has been recently done, and I'm now going to turn to Nithya. Nithya, you were part of this business, but you did this much earlier, right?
That's right.
Can you tell us how your journey has been and talk to us about that?
Yeah, I wish I had studied at this time, because I wish I had a tool like Mindler. I was searching all over the place. I used to travel 950 kilometers up and down from my home just to find a person who would help me find the right coach and right college to study abroad. And two things happened. I traveled extensively and I listened to someone else's advice who most of them had not stepped out of India. So I was frustrated, but I had no choice but to listen to their advice, which apparently was wrong, and I struggled my way through and got a degree finally. And after that, I came to India again to promote one of the colleges, one of the business schools in the UK, help them set up in India. All through the marketing process, I came across students who were stumbling upon the same fact. This happened in 2009, mm-hmm. 10 years ago.
Okay.
And that's when I pledged to start something called as Monkey Baba.
Okay.
So ideally, trying to find information, helping students find information about the courses and colleges, just like how Mindler was trying to do, but it was too early. Okay. And I didn't have the technology or the knowledge to help develop that or scale that.
Great, Nithya. So you're saying that you were here much earlier than all of us?
Yes.
Right? And Monkey Baba was 10 years back?
2009.
2009.
The domain was registered prior to that.
Wow. Wow. So, and then what happened after that?
So I was competing with giants like Siksha, HT Campus, and Minglebox.
Okay.
But we all were doing the same thing.
Okay.
We were all offering the list of courses. We were literally aggregating the courses information and the colleges information from around the world.
Okay, so then fast forward, technology happened, then what? What is happening now? Tell us the recent story.
Yeah, today, companies like Mindler, Lodestar, and ProBano, they're all leading and they're all doing what I was trying to solve then.
Okay.
But we're all thinking about things from the perspective of a student, but we are forgetting the fact that universities are getting as smart as the students.
Okay.
So with access to information, students prepare their careers, I mean, plan their careers way ahead, which is throwing a huge challenge to universities or to careers professionals, with all due respect. They all find it difficult to find the right mind to match to their right course and to the company profile.
So are you saying that you help universities select the right students?
Yeah,
because,
right.
You know, there could be 20,000 students at 96.8%.
Yeah.
Right. So which is the right one for which college and which course? Do you help? How do you do that?
So we've started something called this Admit Story, a new company, which is trying to solve that problem. So imagine we have 20,000 students all having the same marks, I mean, which can be quantified, and they're all equal. And how do the university choose them then? How do how do university pick the right student for their course?
Okay.
So we've developed something called Admit Story, a tool that helps the universities assess the students' statement of purpose.
Oh.
Because that's the only thing that's been done manually. It's not automated yet.
Okay.
So we are trying to crack that, and we've got a couple of universities from the UK on board to use Admit Story. So wherein we are helping the university assess the personality traits or the persona of a student to make to ensure they're getting into the right course. Yeah.
Okay.
To see if they're the right match for them.
So that means parents now, even when you write your statement of purpose, even that can be analyzed with an AI algorithm to make sure the persona is right. Okay, great. We're really getting deep here. Great. Now, you know, thanks Nithya for that story, and I'm sure you'll have many takers here. Murli, not many people know that you're also a second time entrepreneur in this category,
sure.
right?
Yeah.
And you know, our gray hair really gives credence to our age they've been there. But tell us.
When you said the young person, I thought you meant us.
Yeah, yeah, I meant us in between, not the other ones on the side. So tell us from Meritrack to Lodestar, how's the journey been in this segment?
Okay, so I began my entrepreneurial journey with Meritrack, which was founded in 2000. And Meritrack was India's largest skills assessment company, which I co-founded, and then it got acquired by the Manipal Group. So at Meritrack, we did things at scale, where we helped India to really professionalize its assessment process, and we helped large IT companies like Microsoft, Accenture, HP to you know, hire large numbers of people through a standardized automated process of this thing. And we also helped conduct large entrance exams, like the Vellore Institute of Technology entrance exam is done by Meritrack. So while we're building that, one of the things that occurred to us is that we're helping large numbers of people get into these IT companies. They're getting a good job, you know, but a lot of them are lost in what they want to do later, right? They don't know why they got the IT job. After the excitement with the coffee and the AC wears off, they're really back at the thing of figuring out why we want to do this. That's where we conceptualized Lodestar, and we've been working on this for about 5 years now. We really wanted to crack the problem of guidance. So many of the questions that we are trying to answer here, that Prateek has talked about, or you know, other panelists have talked about, is that how do we bring science to this? Mm-hmm. Okay, and having built an, and when I say science, most people think that science means assessments, right? Okay, you've got a fantastic assessment battery, and that's the science here. But having built a large assessment company, I can confidently tell you that an assessment is like a blood report. Mm-hmm. Okay, you start with a blood report, but you don't end with that. A blood report is just an indication of the many possibilities for an individual, right? What strengths, what personality, etc. What needs fixing, and as Prateek also alluded to that little thing, is that what do you do with the blood report? Are you able to build an intelligent algorithm which takes the softer aspects and the harder cognitive aspects and match it to the right career? Then how do you enable career discovery at scale? Mm-hmm. How do you then link it to the education decisions that a person has to do? See, one of the challenges, so we built a platform which is now being used by about 40,000 plus children across 150 plus schools. Mm-hmm. And one of the things we've achieved is extremely high user acceptance rates. So one of the things we track is that every parent who goes through this, we ask them, forget all excellent, good, etc. Were you able to make a decision? Because I can build a Google-like system, but if the parent says at the end of it, I'm still confused, then the whole thing has not worked. So at Lodestar, we've achieved a metric of, say, 93% of our parents are saying this, yes, I could make a decision.
Okay.
And say similar number says that all the questions that I've answered, that I asked the system and your counselor were answered. So this needs automation, not only at the mapping or the career discovery level, but needs automation in figuring out even simpler decisions like what stream I will take, what elective subject I'll take there, what exam I will choose. Okay, let me give you a quick example, one quick example here. So most students in Bangalore and Chennai and all that will choose science. Okay, when you choose science, you'll say there's no decision to be made, because once I choose science, I will get into a coaching institute and I will write all the engineering entrance exams. But in India, there are maybe a dozen engineering entrance exams.
Yes.
So parents have this mindset saying that, okay, I have done coaching, so all the entrance exams are equal to all each other, but it's not true. For example, one entrance exam is like the 100 meter race, the other entrance exam is like a marathon. Okay, so parents don't understand this, and the kid doesn't understand this. If you don't understand the difference, then you're going to just prepare for the 100 meters and be running the marathon, and you'll never succeed. So the decision required is at that fine-tuned level.
Okay.
So you've got to build a system which will help the parents figure out that my child has to write engineering entrance exams. Is this at the, is he capable of writing the GE advanced exam? Is he capable of writing the GE mains exam or the CET exam or what? And what is the best choice for him? Otherwise, you're saying that you can become an engineer and all this you decide, the parent will never be able to. So it is personalized. It is highly data algorithm driven.
Okay.
So, and it has to be very, very specific. Okay. One of the problems when you talked about, principles and all that, and the trouble they face. See, this is an evolving market. So most of the educators feel that, a career guidance is about either a talk or an assessment. They need to figure out that actually parents out there are making fine decisions.
So it's a process. It's not just one intervention.
Absolutely.
It's over a period of time.
Yes.
And the platforms are subscription based, go over a period of time. They're given inputs to validate.
Yes.
And Prateek also talked about that. But
yes.
I have a totally different thought process here is, everything changes in every 4 or 5 years, right? So, what students are learning today in grade 8, they don't even know what careers and jobs they will take up when they're 23, right? Which is 15 years later. So, is there any rationale for doing this? Because what careers or roles option which may exist do not even exist today. So how do you prepare for that? And are you doing something in that area, Aditya, to guide them? Because most of the roles which will be there do not exist today.
Yeah, absolutely. So one aspect that I talked about is, technology, there are three aspects of technology we can use in career guidance. One is the content. How to make the right career choice, self-exploration, what should I know about myself to make the right career choice? What are the different career choices available to me? If I talk about engineering, within engineering what? Civil engineering, okay, within civil engineering what? Within criminal law what? Within civil law what, right?
So but again, so let me get off this engineering track because most of the time, it's either engineering or medicine,
but
the most sought after job is a data scientist.
Right.
And so who would have recommended people to become a data scientist 5 years back?
Absolutely.
Right? Or a career in retail, right? So is there any tool out there or are you looking at that segment which is beyond the engineering, beyond the regular domain? Any of you would talk
right.
about
so,
that?
Yeah. What we can, so right now what we can do as, career guides or as, people who are given the responsibility of guiding the students towards their future, which even we don't have a full idea of. One thing is we need to prepare them for making decisions, right? How to make the right decisions according to what features in myself and according to what features in the market. How should I map my own self to the different careers out there, which are changing with time. So, earlier I was just doing some research on careers. The interest inventories earlier used to have all these positions like clerk, assistant typist and all that. Most of those careers are irrelevant now. But what they really did is they had a really good structure around it. Using that structure, you can now fit in data science, you can now fit in artificial intelligence, you can now fit UX designer. All these careers did not exist 10 or 15 years back. So we have to train them to make the decisions. In the machine age, things are changing exponentially. So in this exponential change age, we have to train them to make the right decisions through a very solid framework. So that they are put at the center of their career decision rather than us just giving them a psychometric test to put just recommend them some careers that has to be there, but that has to be used as a tool.
So any of you have a different thought process?
My view is that this whole thing about the world is changing too fast is overrated.
Okay.
If you just look at data of the number of graduates who come out of science, arts, commerce, engineering, etc., 95% of them are still looking at traditional careers. Point number one. Okay, in the traditional careers, the work environment maybe has changed a little bit. So an example is, I'm still a marketeer, but I do digital marketing. Okay, but I'm still at heart a marketer. Okay. There could be a few roles in digital marketing which are slightly more tech oriented, which did not require marketing, but essentially you're still a marketeer, right? So like this, and a majority of the, at least in India, the reality is 95%, 96% of the people are still looking at traditional careers. Mm-hmm. So this whole thing that the whole world is changing, so I will not do career guidance, I think completely wrong.
Okay.
And the child at least at 11th, 12th and entry of college needs a direction. Even if the world is so changing, I have to make a choice of a course.
Mm-hmm.
If I don't know myself, as he said, and if I don't know what I want to do later in life, how will I make the choice of a course?
Okay. So the I'm going to flip it to Prateek and Nithya. You know, is there any future validation? Because, okay, accepted that there's a platform, you guide them. How do you know that the guidance is turning right? Because, you know, at the end of it, you know, you go through test prep and somebody says, hey, listen, 89 of my students became, you know, successful in this exam. So that's validation. Is there a forward validation of the platform or of the career guidance that we provide today?
So it's a very, very popular question amongst the investors also. So almost every meeting I answer that. But yeah, three big elements, okay? One is the pure statistical and the theoretical validity, which once you're building a psychometric tool, you have to put in data. We standardized and validated it over 16 million data points. That's the kind of data research that we did. So that is one, wherein at that point of time, does it give you the statistical validity, the alpha scores and all? So that's one bit. Two is genuine customer feedback at the point of usage, okay, which is what we call at data collection in terms of a thumbs up or the number of hearts you get or something like that. Which could be from multiple stakeholders. And during the testing phase, we would look at principals, we would look at teachers, we would look at parents, we would look at students, their response. The third is immediate validity in terms of concurrent validity, which is you ask this assessment tool to be practitioned on a individual who's actually pursuing a career, that particular career, know his happiness index, and then map it back.
Backwards.
Okay, that's where your regression and all those analytical tools comes into being. And then the last bit, which is something which the opinion is still open, is 7 years down the line, does that user feel that he took the right decision, A? B, is he happy in it?
Hmm.
Now, that's where we do. So we have built in algorithms which map, we have connected them to LinkedIn so that we can at least track which domains they are in.
Okay.
But the challenge there, which I've seen globally from all these conferences also, is that there are multiple other variables that come into play. For instance, digital marketing could be great for me as an individual. I work with Google, I love it. I work with any small company doing the same work, I don't like it because I don't like my boss. The variables are way too many to be able to do the future validity in that sense out there. But still, organizations like us, we need to map that index. Today, basis all the 2-3 years data that we have fed in, we hit a 97.2 accuracy. When I say that is, if I have taken a student in grade 10th, or 11th, and over the last 3 years, what have we recommended, what they have pursued, we then map which college have they gone into and what course are they pursuing. We hit a 97.2 accuracy among the top 3 matches that we recommended. So that's the kind of validity we are already doing, but yeah, this is something which is still
going to be proved out. Picture abhi baki hai, but you've got till to the college level, you got it right.
Correct.
Dithya, do you think you can add there?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I would like to add it from a university's perspective. The fact that universities are competing to get the brightest students shows that students have got clear idea as to what they want to do in their life.
Mm-hmm.
And thanks to these startups, I think students are now able to map their career plan, and they are demanding the right kind of course from the university. So the universities are like competing to get the brightest minds and the best minds to get into their place.
Okay.
So the places have become very competitive. So I'd like to see that trend happening. I mean, that trend validates the fact that yes, it is.
So could the statement of purpose audit prove that the platform recommendation was right within the right category or not, right?
Yeah, it's not just about the statement of purpose, Kaushik. It's also about the fact that the universities are flocking into different countries, setting up their bases, setting up their houses in different countries shows the need to grab the best minds.
Great. So, just another thing, I want to just be careful of the questions with the audience threw up. I think we've answered quite a bit, but I don't think we've covered advice for boring careers and retail and stuff, right? Skill mismatch, right? Why would you want to do, why would you advise somebody to sell soap across the beat in a tough market in a, FMCG scenario or selling pharma medicines? Is there any recommendation for that? How do you deal with first, how do you spot that the person may not fit in to a regular, or a much more glamorous career option? How do you break the news that you are not, you shouldn't recommend you to go into a high-end, or a flashy area and go into a more tough or a, role like a retail or a pharma sales guy or a person, a pharma salesperson, and how do you break the news? In what fashion?
One is, you also have to understand that there are multiple exit points for students today. It's not necessarily only after 12. Students even exit at grade 10, go diploma courses, 12, go vocational courses, after graduation, and then obviously after post-graduation, one. Two, I think at any stage, mapping of the emotional intelligence and personality quotient is a huge variable that can add, because technically you can't map the ability of a student to do a particular job, for example, welding. Now, I can't do any assessment to map whether the kid will be good at welding, except for, I know of a few companies in Singapore who are trying to do something on this line, which is more human-based, and most of the skill development companies are also trying to use that. But I think in terms of, let's say, I'm looking at cabin crew as a career, okay? Now, I would look at few elements in my assessment tool, resilience, emotional regulation. At 30,000 feet, I can't get mad even if a customer is getting mad at me. Now, those skills are there. If you don't have it, you don't have it. If you have it, you are fit for these careers. Similarly, if you go more towards the white collar side, careers like medicine, civil services, chartered accountancy, they are very long drawn careers. Actuarial sciences, students need to have a lot of patience and maturity to be there, patient, work hard, consistently do that. So I think that's a big element which can be mapped early, and a direction can be given leveraging that.
So only your take, and especially on how, you know, what advice would you give the parents of these students? Because the students might still take the advice and look at it open-mindedly, but what about parents who are, as our friend mentioned, you know, painful parents who really want the kids to go into the finey, shiny careers?
So one of the strategic things that we've decided in when we started Lodestar was that we will make parents a mandatory part of the career guidance process.
Okay.
So this is one lacuna in the field, which I see sometimes, companies that. So if you advise a child, it is that advice is never going to be durable. So parent has to mandatorily buy in, and there should be consensus. Only then you're going to really make impact. Having said that, what we tell parents is that every career is great. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I have lots of data where I share when we talk to parents, etc., to say that. Let's not have this. So at least at Lodestar, we firmly believe there's no concept like a sexy career and a uncool career. No, not at all. Every career is good. What is very important to note is that how does your personality, interest, and aptitude match to that? If that matches, then you're going to be a great, successful person in this career. Now I'll ask you a question. When I do this in schools and colleges, I say that, especially with parents and in schools, I say that, do you think teaching is a paying career? Okay, and if your audience of parents, etc., they will say, nobody will say yes. Mm-hmm. So somebody will say yes, okay, slowly. They will say, okay, would you encourage your son to go into teaching? They'll say no. Okay, it's a highly noble career, but it's not a paying career. Mm-hmm. But I have got a WhatsApp message in my phone which says that if you can teach XYZ, okay, and you're from this institute, then there's a 30 lakh salary per annum available. When I tell this to parents, that as a teacher you could earn 30 lakh rupees an annum, okay, salary, people are stunned. So what is happening here is there's a lack of data. They don't know that. But for a 30 lakh salary annum, and a 25-year-old can earn that, right? What is the job? Who's the guy who's fit for that? That you have to figure out. So we say there's no uncool career. Every career you can be a star, okay? The fact is, have you figured out what is the career in which you will be a star?
Okay.
Can I chip in with another?
Yes, please.
So basically, what I feel in this is that so we were talking about unsexy careers, you know, as we put it. So retail, machinist, and all that. Now we have also got to understand that while there are very high-paying, amazing careers out there, we also have to pay a bit of attention to statistics here. The dropout rate in schools is very high after high school, right? 10th, many students drop out. In disability, the number is even higher. National Career Service Portal, if you look it up, ncs.gov.in, there are a lot of people still looking for jobs. They haven't gotten jobs yet, even in the skill section. NSDC is working its way through and through to, kind of trying to get those people to work, right? So even these students, we have to pay a lot of attention to. So, we have to get them started with at least careers, which they can earn a decent living through, ensuring a bright future for themselves, ensuring a bright future for their families. So as Mr. Murali said, right, so there is no uncool career as such, right? Be it a machinist, be it a gardener, be it, in BFSI, in retail, any career. We have to initially map their personality, their aptitude, their values, and their interests to that career, so that they initially get started with something which can they can, you know, at least earn through and they can stay happy through, right? So at least, you know, we can improve those labor force numbers, you know, 0.1%, 0.5%, 10% into the labor force aren't really good numbers. So at least we can push them into those skill-based careers to have a good start.
Okay. So the concept is, let's try to, through this effort, make children choose careers in which they'll be great at something, not average at many things. Okay. Because India as a culture has this whole thing that my kid has to get, you know, A grade in 5 subjects. Mm. I say, why? Okay, do you know that Infosys has just announced this year, that they're going to hire 1,000 arts and science graduates to do user experience design work, right? And when I go to, in my, you know, my daughter's school, out of 36 children, one of the top schools in Bangalore, 33 children choose science. They'll never get a job as a user experience designer. Correct. Infosys feels that arts and design and, you know, that thinking is very important. Google has jobs like that. They are hiring psychologists. They hired 3,000 psychologists last year for user experience work. So the point is that you've got to be a good psychologist. You've got to be a good, you know, arts grad or a design grad. If you're an average arts grad, you're never going to get anywhere.
So on that sound consulting advice that you've got to be good at what you do, and one A grade is good enough rather than all 5 A grades. I'll come to him. I saw his hand. We're going to wrap the panel and get to some more questions. If you have two questions, okay, on both on this side, gentleman in the back. There you go. Okay.
Now, this is on vocational stuff.
Yes.
We have trained youngsters to do vocational jobs. They are doing good welding or good stuff. They are not willing to go out far away, but the company is not willing to employ them. So how does it match? You say that this guy is good at X or Y, but when that guy who is good at welding is not getting a job within the area where he wants to get, it obviously becomes uncool and unsexy. It's like, I'm a good cricketer, but I cannot join the Ranji Trophy or any other team. I should have alternatives. So the prime focus that you choose your passion, etc., is a load of unadulterated bullshit. We'll have to balance it out with what is available on ground, because I've seen this happen day in and day out. People want to become X, Y. He's good at it. We encourage her to do that. When it comes to the business end of it, companies are not willing to pay, or they say, profits, roni, roti, etc. We want to get the guy who is paid less. Got How it. Do we balance that out?
Got it. So equally loaded, unadulterated, that you mentioned, is the fact that you will get your choice of job in the same locality, because the jobs have changed, right? So before I come to you guys, there are options available of working without a firm job, and a skill is always available. For example, there are multiple projects across the country where a good welder or a good machinist are required. And have you heard of a thing called a gig economy? It doesn't mean that you have to have a fixed job with a company. There are skills which are available and they are in peak demand and they're available. So hang on, no rebuttals, please.
And we'll do a disservice to the whole market. Career guidance is about providing a viable solution. And a viable solution has multiple elements. It has assessment element, it has career awareness element, it has the job opportunity element. So for example, I've got some skill like welding, and I figure out the job opportunity is not in my town in Tumkur, then it's not a viable option. So I have to then think, and skill won't be exactly welding, skill will be one higher level. So that skill, what is the viable option I have to think out? And if a viable option means that I have to work in Delhi, then that is a reality which we have to tell the child. I'll give you a quick example here. For example, a lot of children are very good at physics. So they will say, I love physics, so I'll study physics in undergraduate. Okay, I think it's a very vague statement to make. What do you mean by studying physics? Because after studying physics for 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, PhD, what do you do? Now the children have thought it out. So child will be 98% or 100% in school, and he starts studying physics. He doesn't figure out that if I study physics, the options are I'll be a teacher, an American university or an Indian university, I'll be a theoretical physics researcher in perimeter in Canada, or I'll be a
researcher in some place. Now, these job options should be clear to me, and I should be willing to work in that, and I should be happy with the salary that it offers. So suppose I thought that I'll get a great rank in IIT, right, and I want salary, then you'd rather do computer science at IIT Bombay or Delhi and get a 30 lakh package, okay, rather than figure out and go to like Princeton and be a lecturer in physics. You'll never own the big car. So you got to figure that out. So just to answer, sir, that detailing has to be told to the student. That I'm good at child. Yeah, child will be great. But suppose you're trained in cricket and you're in like Nigeria, you'll never play, make the big bucks, right? You have to be in India playing the IPL that way. So the career guidance has to take care of this comprehensive advice. Only then a relevant advice has to be given.
And it has to be taken and then followed.